Welcome to this week's midweek space news. I'm going to cover some space stories that have come up recently. Before we get into the stories, here is our X account at Space Startup Hub. So please follow us on there for notification about new videos and various posts on space topics. Okay, so without further ado, let's get into the first story this week. And this story is from the UK and it's on a robotic welding project to prepare UK for in-orbit repairs. So I've just marked up a few areas in the article just to give you a gist of what it's about. And with all these stories, you'll find links in the video description if you want to read in detail about them. So it says here that UK's first in-space robotic welding capability, known as Project Iceberg, the Intelligent Space Arc Welding Robotic Kit, is designed to test a robot-mounted arc welding system intended for in-orbit repair, structural joining, and future orbital manufacturing. Iceberg advances the UK's and the world's capability for in-space repair and manufacturing, and they're developing and enabling the technology that could redefine how large structures are built and maintained in orbit. And they're going to say it supports a more responsible and resilient space economy where repairing, adapting, and eventually manufacturing structures in orbit could reduce waste, extend mission lifetimes, and open new options for long-term exploration. So that's the article. It reminds me of some space startups I've covered on this channel already. For instance, if I put myself in the corner, this is Space Quarters Startup, which is a Japanese company that are working on welding robots for in-space assembly and manufacturing. So they have big plans on the website for unleashing just huge, massive structures in space that would be assembled by robots and then metallic parts would be welded together. In addition to that, we also have Think Orbital, which is a US company, and the spherical spheres you can see are basically welded together. They get launched as a stack of tiles and then a welding robotic arm puts them together and then welds them into a single sphere. And these spheres could be 4,000 cubic meters. That's about 20 diameters, so absolutely massive in volume, about four times the volume of the International Space Station, and that's just one sphere. This is their roadmap. So you can see that they have multi-use space platforms in low Earth orbit by 2028. And then they have the geostationary platform for satellite servicing and refueling in 2030. And then they have some kind of station around the moon at 2035. And 2040, they have stations around asteroids for asteroid mining. So they're very ambitious. We also have a video from them. If I play that, I just make sure the sound's down. There's the sound on this one. Put myself in the corner. So this is their robotic welding arm. So basically, it's an articulated arm. And at the end, you have electron beam welding end effector. So you can see it attached to a satellite. And the end effector there can weld. Yeah, you can see it there welding metal sheets together. And it uses electron beam welding, which gives a very strong weld. It requires a vacuum, but that's not a problem in space. They can produce welds in space. They've done that already. And then you can see an actual weld at the end there. And from using this system, you can build very large structures in space. So you send them flat packed on a starship, and then you use a robotic arm to like assemble them. And you can use it for the moon as well, for lunar based construction. I'm not sure when their next mission is. They've already flown on the International Space Station just to test out the welding system. A few space startups working on that. Space Quarters from Japan and Think Orbital from the US. And the UK is getting involved in that as well as some kind of project from the UK Space Agency. So let's move on to the second story this week. This article says that K2 Space has raised $250 million Series C funding. So it's valued at $3 billion before even launching a satellite. Ahead of its first satellite launch early next year, that'll be in 2026, K2 has secured more than $500 million in contracts across government and commercial customers, a major selling point for the new funding round. It's time to build bigger, and we intend to be on the vanguard of doing just that, Karen Kunjer, CEO of K2, said. Their plan is to develop ultra-powerful, large-scale spacecraft by leveraging additional capacity expected from super-heavy launch vehicles like SpaceX's Starship. So they're waiting for Starship to open up to commercial flights and payload capacity for crafts like K2's planned gigabuses. But in the meantime, K2 plans to launch a smaller but still powerful satellite class called Mega, with the first flight expected in March. K2 will test its 20 kilowatt Hall effect thrusters, which company officials say would be the most powerful flown to date. They are rethinking satellite design from ground up, and the result is a platform that can support entirely new classes of missions. After the first Mega flight in March, several more missions are planned during the next 2 years. K2 says it will start deploying constellations for customers in 2028. From there, the company plans to launch its Giga line of satellites, which require a super heavy rocket like Starship or Blue Origin's New Glenn. So that's the article. So I've done a video on K2 Space already, but just to recap. So their business plan is to build and deploy very large satellite buses. And the thinking is we're going to have heavy and super heavy commercial launch soon with SpaceX Starship and Blue Origin's New Glenn. And of course, New Glenn is going to get even bigger and more powerful. So K2 Space is seeing what's coming with the commercial launchers and is now designing satellite buses that take full advantage of the mass and volume available in the payload fairings. So in this graphic, we can see that they say there's only been 16,000 tons that humans are putting to orbit so far, and that the total mass per year of a Starship per year, with an average of 3 launches per week, is 23,000 tons, and the total mass into orbit from 10 Starships per year with an average 3 launches per day is 1.7 million tons. So there's going to be no constraints on mass, not many constraints on volume, because obviously the Starship has a 9-meter diameter. We have a look at this graphic from K2 Space. We can see the satellite cost and the payload mass, which normally track with each other, but that's not the case with the K2 bus. The mass is large, but the satellite cost isn't. And this is a render of what the satellite bus will look like. So it's a large satellite bus with solar panels and ion thrusters at the back. And they're building two classes of satellite buses, the Mega class, which will launch next year, and the Giga class, which requires super heavy lift. So Mega class is 3 meters by 3 meters, which is still very substantial in size. The satellite bus will be over 4.5 tons and will use 20 kilowatt Krypton Hall effect thrusters. And the even bigger Giga class, we don't really have a diameter dimensions so far, but speculating it's going to be probably at least 5 meters by 5 meters, if not more. And it will weigh over 15 metric tons. Potentially it would have very high power ion thrusters, something between 40 to 60 kilowatts of power. And this graphic shows you the kind of commercial launchers that could potentially launch their satellite buses. So in green, it says all medium launch vehicles, that's Falcon 9, Neutron, and so on, can lift the Mega class satellites. So there's no problem at all with Mega class satellites. But for the Giga class, because of the diameter, it's likely to be only SpaceX's Starship and Blue Origin's New Glenn. So New Glenn has a diameter of 7 meters, so it should be able to launch Giga class, and obviously Starship with its 9-meter diameter and effective payload diameter of around 8 meters should be able to launch them as well. So that's very interesting. But another point I want to make is, if you look at this graphic, and this is a screenshot from Jared Isaacman's Project Athena document that was leaked recently, and I did a video on it. You can see under the nuclear propulsion section, under key contacts and commercial interest, you'll see K2. So seeing K2 and seeing companies like Antares Nuclear, which is building micro nuclear reactors, you can see how Jared is thinking. You can have a K2 satellite bus, which has very powerful ion thrusters already integrated into it. If you then add a micro nuclear reactor, you can power the ion thrusters using the nuclear reactor, and you've got a nuclear powered spacecraft. So I don't think it's any accident that under the nuclear section, you see K2 Space, you also see Antares Nuclear. Okay, our next story is on a combined mission between Impulse Space and Starfish Space. So let's have a look at that article. So Starfish Space completes autonomous rendezvous and proximity mission in LEO with Impulse Space. So this is two startups, Impulse Space, which provides the space tug or the spacecraft vehicle, and Starship Space, which provides the technology for rendezvous and proximity operations. This mission validated key Starfish software for autonomous satellite guidance and showcased Impulse's precise maneuvering capabilities. So these two companies announced the successful completion of the Remora mission and Autonomous Rendezvous and Proximity Operations, or RPO, demonstration in low Earth orbit. It's a fully autonomous rendezvous executed by Starfish with a single lightweight camera system and closed-loop guidance navigation and control software running on a peripheral flight computer. Uses Impulse's Mirror spacecraft, Starfish's payloads enabled Mirror to perform close proximity maneuvers with another Impulse Mirror spacecraft on orbit. Starfish software autonomously controlled the LEO Express 2 Mirror, guiding the satellite through a series of maneuvers, and it closed to within approximately 1,250 meters of the LEO Express 1 Mirror, operating with just a single visual range camera as the only sensor. This validated Starfish's core guidance, navigation, and control software, and Starfish has missions launching for SES, the US Space Force, NASA, and additional customers. Starfish proved that it can conduct precise orbital operations more efficiently, safely, and affordably than legacy approaches. And it says here again, fully autonomous guidance and control throughout the maneuver. And this gives us tremendous confidence as we move towards our first auto launches next year. So the mission showcased the precise maneuvering capabilities of Impulse's high-thrust spacecraft, Mirror. Mirror is our agile, responsive spacecraft. Its maneuverability and high thrust make it perfectly suited for this type of mission. We're looking forward to more RPO missions across more orbits in the future. And the modular compatibility positions Starfish and Impulse to enable a wide range of future remote proximity operation missions. And this mission was developed in just 9 months. So that gives you an idea of just how agile both of these companies are. They went from the concept of this operation to a fully functional mission in just 9 months. So a little more about Starfish. They're working on the autonomous satellite servicing vehicle, a spacecraft bus with an arm, a docking adapter. And obviously the software is very important for operating near another spacecraft. So they've just validated that now with the Remora mission. And as you can see from this one here, you've got the Otter spacecraft on the left, and you can see this docking adapter, the orange, yellow, orange thing, and that can attach to a client satellite. And from there, you can use a robotic arm, or you could just push it into the Earth's atmosphere to burn it up, like orbital debris missions, or life extension missions, or all kinds of different kind of missions as well. And this is a graphic from Starfish about the different phases. So you've got the rendezvous phase, you've got an inspect phase, and then approach phase, and maybe even a docking phase. So those are the different kinds of operations they can do. Okay, so our last story this week is on InnoSpace, which is a South Korean space startup, and they're now getting very close to launching their Hambit Nano vehicle from Alcantara Space Center in Brazil. So let's have a look at this video. I've just turned the sound off, so we can see it's already on the pad, doing the final checks before launching, which I believe is probably on the 20th of December. So you can see it being assembled here. It has payloads on board from Brazil, and there you can see it being rolled out of the hangar and heading towards the launch pad. So this is a orbital vehicle, and it will be the very first orbital vehicle by InnoSpace. They have a range of vehicles they're working on. You can see it here at Alcantara Space Center, which is in Brazil. And yeah, it's on the pad and it's now ready to launch in the next couple of days. So they have a launch window, I think the 20th of December. It could have been launching today, but I think it's been rolled back for a few days. Okay, so that's the video. And in addition to that, we have, put myself in the corner here, we have the live stream. I'll post this link in the video description if you want to watch the launch live. So it says live in 2 days, December 20th at 1:45 a.m. You can be notified about the launch and watch it. So hopefully we'll get to see the launch live in a few days. So that would be amazing. And the very first orbital launch by a commercial South Korean company, InnoSpace. So that is the news this week. And I will be working on a video coming out later this week, which will be on all the latest information from Blue Origin. So we know there's a more powerful version of New Glenn. It doesn't have a great name. It's called 9X4, which is it's 9 engines on the first stage and 4 on the second. But I think it can lift 71 tons into low Earth orbit. So I'll be looking at that. But I will also be looking at their simplified architecture for landing crew on the moon using a Mark 1 cargo lunar lander. But it can be modified to land crew. So I will go over that in the video this week. And yeah, basically all the information on Blue Origin. To begin with, they didn't really do much. There wasn't a lot of progress we could see. But they're now executing extremely quickly. They've got your New Glenn, got New Shepard, you've got Blue Ring. They're working on the Mars telecommunications orbiter. They've got Mark 1 lander, Mark 2 crewed lander. And they're working on cryogenic storage of propellants in orbit, their cislunar transporter. So they are now executing very quickly. And of course, they're working on the AI compute as well, I believe, because everyone's working on that. So anyway, that will be my next video out this week. So thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.